Welcome. This is True to His Word with Brian Larson, Senior Pastor of Calvary Chapel of Truckee. Join us, won't you, as we spend a few minutes together in God's Word.
You know, being a Christian, or the Christian life, let me put it that way. The Christian life really comes down to this, the very essence of it. It's Jesus Christ in you, and it's you in Jesus Christ. That's a pretty phenomenal thing. Jesus told his disciples in John 15:5, I'm the vine, you are the branches. Of course, the branches are part of the vine, aren't they? I'm the vine and you're the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. Paul says in the first chapter of Colossians, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Now think about that for a minute. Think of the reality of that. That should make you kind of a very peculiar, different, you might say, unique type of person in this world. And indeed it does, brethren. Chapter 4 begins with this admonishment to us with these things in mind. Notice what he says in verse 1, Paul, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling to which you were called. In other words, he's calling us as believers now to walk in a way commensurate with the high calling, the unique position that we have as his children in this world. In other words, walk like Jesus Christ himself is really in you. And you are really in him, which is, brethren, it's the fact of the matter. It's the way it is. How do you do that? Well, that's what chapter 4 is all about. Actually, that's what chapters 4 to 6 are about. It's about that walk. For instance, notice what he said in verse 7 of chapter 4. But to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. He has given each of us his grace. Brethren, that's active grace. That's help from on high. That's undeserved favor and help of God in your life. Anything that would be necessary to walk according to that calling to which you've been called, there's his grace to help that happen in your life. Notice what he says going on in verse 8. Therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts to men. Now this, verse 9, he ascended. What does it mean? But that he also first descended into the lower parts of the earth. But he who descended is also the one who ascended far above all the heavens that he might fill all things. The point about it, we're talking about the one here who came and he died and he victoriously rose again from the dead, ascending into heaven, and he's on the throne of God right now as I speak to you, brethren. And that means he is in a position where he can ably do what he said he can do for you. That grace is abundantly available to us. Now, we come to verse 11 this morning. And he's also provided special gifts. He said he gave gifts to men. He's provided special gifts to the body of Christ as a whole. In other words, special gifts from the Lord himself to the churches. And these gifts are specially designed for the spiritual equipping of the believers, to help equip them for that wonderful calling on their life. And so look at the Lord's gifts to the churches. We pick it up now in verse 11. Notice, and he himself gave some to be apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. And what he's saying, the Lord has faithfully over the years called out and raised up and gifted spiritually certain men and given them as gifts to the body of Christ. the emphasis here is his love for the body. He cares about his children. I remember early on in my ministry, it was after I'd had a particularly, Bible study, you know. It was one of those, Bible studies. And I was on my way home. And I was like, well, that was a good one, Lord. And the Lord spoke to me so clearly. And essentially, he said, if I choose to bless your ministry in any way, it's not because there's anything special about you. It's because I love my people. It's for them. And that's what he's describing here. And essentially he says, I've raised up four different callings, four different positions, four different offices for the body of Christ from the Lord to minister to the body and to help them be what God's called them to be. And he lists four of them. He said apostles first. First, apostles. Apostles, the word simply means sent ones. And in Scripture, they are ones who had been ordained and sent out by Jesus Christ himself. Listen to what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, 7 to 9. After that, talking about Jesus after his resurrection, he was seen by James and then all the apostles. Then last of all, Paul says, he was seen by me also on the Damascus Road as one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles who am not even worthy to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But the point about it is, those who were the apostles were those who had seen the risen Jesus Christ personally and were commissioned and called by Jesus Christ to be sent out there with the message, the gospel of Jesus Christ. And as such, they were the foundation layers for the church. They laid that foundation for the living church of Jesus Christ. And I can sit there and say, Lord, thank you. Thank you for your apostles. Thank you for the likes of Peter and James and John and Paul and the blessing and the inspiration that they are to us. To this day, thank you, Lord, for those apostles. And then the second thing he mentions are prophets. Now, he's talking about something more than simply exercising a gift of prophecy, which is legitimate, which can happen in the body of Christ. But he's talking again about an office, a position in the church of being a prophet. This person is a prophet. You see, follow me now. Before the New Testament was completed and compiled, all they had was the Old Testament. And God raised up apostles and prophets that inspired by the Holy Spirit, were able to faithfully share New Testament truth about Jesus before there was a New Testament. And they were very much like Old Testament prophets for the New Testament church. And you know, the requirement of a prophet of God was 100% accuracy. 100%. Had to be right on. And God says in his word, if they're wrong on any count, discount them, reject them, they're not a prophet of mine, God said. My prophets will be 100% accurate. So as with the apostles, these men were raised up and were foundational to the laying of the foundation of the body of Christ, of the church, just very much as the Old Testament prophets were. We see this earlier in Ephesians. Look at chapter 2, verse 19. Look back at chapter 2, verse 19. Now therefore, you, Christian, are no longer strangers or foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, there they are, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. These apostles and prophets laid the foundation for the church. And that foundation has been laid. You know, Revelation chapter 22, Jesus said this in verse 18, for I testify that everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book. If anyone adds to these words, God will add to him the plagues that are written in this book. And so, you know, God's laid that foundation. Now that foundation is being built upon. To generation by generation, he's building upon that foundation that they have laid. So what it comes down to, and this is my take on it, that the Bible, Old and New Testament, brethren, are our apostles and prophets. And what a wonderful gift that is. I'm blessed to this day by the apostles and the prophets, and I thank God for that gift to the church. You know, what a major blessing. This is important, and I want to share this. I've seen modern times somebody being raised up and kind of calling himself a self-appointed apostle or a prophet. I'm a prophet of God, or I'm an apostle of God. And brethren, all I can say about that is all I have seen is people being misled by that kind of thing. That's all I've ever witnessed. You know, I think if anybody could fall in that category in modern history, it would be somebody like Chuck Smith, who God raised up to begin this, be the inspiration behind this whole Calvary Chapel worldwide movement. And I want you to know that Chuck refused ever to be called an apostle or a prophet. He says, no, I'm a pastor, teacher, and look what God has done, you know? So Jesus and the apostles warned us about false apostles and false prophets, especially in the last days, especially as we're getting near the end of the age and the coming of Christ. Talking in that context, Matthew 7:15, Jesus said, "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves." In Matthew 24, here's where he's talking about the end times. "Then many false prophets will arise and deceive many." And then Revelation 2:2, "I know your works, your labor, your patience, that you cannot bear those who are evil," talking to the church at Ephesus. "And you have tested those who say they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars." So there's that warning. Let me reiterate here, brethren, the gifts of the Spirit are given to the body of Christ. And there are gifts that fall into, you know, kind of prophetic ability or church planting ability and things like that. But as far when it comes to the office, the position of an apostle or a prophet, the way I see it right there in Ephesians, he makes clear that they were the ones that laid the foundation for us. And that foundation is being built on now by the advancement of the body of Christ. And he said, but there's others. There's those who were foundational. But there's also, and he goes on and notice he says evangelists. He says, some evangelists. These are ones that have been called and specifically gifted for proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ to the lost in a clear, understandable, effective, convincing way that just, you know, calls people to faith in Jesus Christ and are very fruitful at it. That's an evangelist, and they're gifts to the church, to the body of Christ. You know, in the colonial period, there was George Whitefield. And God used him as an instrument in what's been called the Great Awakening in our country. And literally thousands of colonials came to Jesus Christ and rededicated their life to following Christ through that man's ministry. What an evangelist. In the 19th century, there was Dwight L. Moody. What a ministry that man had in calling people in the English-speaking world to Christ in particular. In the 20th century, we had Billy Graham, didn't we? And look at the way God used that man. And then there's men like Greg Laurie or Raul Reese and many others who have a gift of evangelism. And they're evangelists to the church. And the church is benefiting from that. The church is growing from that ministry. There are some pastors local church pastors who'll go into an area and start a church, and you can see they're more of an evangelist than they are a pastor. And God'll begin to build a work there, and once it gets going, that person will move on to another area because they feel called to do that, you know? They're an evangelist. Thank God for the evangelists. You know, there's a gift of evangelism. And that means right down in the context of a local body of believers, there can be those who have a heart for evangelism, a heart to see people that don't know Jesus. And God will use them. God will use them to help bring people to Jesus Christ in one way or another. An evangelist doesn't mean he's an awesome soul winner. It means he's got a heart for people to know the truth and know Jesus. He may be a seed planter, planting seeds all over the place, you know? And then somebody else comes along and, you know, harvests the crop. But what a gift to the body of Christ. And then finally, he says there are pastors and teachers. And I want to point something out here. We use the word some between these two. I mean, he said some as apostles, some as prophets, some as pastors and teachers. You could almost hyphenate that. Those that are called to be a pastor teacher. Now, the word pastor comes from a word that means shepherding or to shepherd. You know, it's got shepherding in view. It's like when Jesus called Peter at the end of the book of John. And three times he said, "Peter, do you love me? Tend my sheep. Feed my sheep, Peter. Take care of my lamb." You know, that's a pastor. How does he do that? Primary means of doing that. He's a teacher. He teaches the word of God. He teaches the whole counsel of God. Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, "Be diligent to present yourself approved of God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing or accurately handling the word of truth." Scripture, God's word. Sharing with the people what the Lord is saying through his word in the context in which he's saying it and as it relates to the whole body of the truth in his word. Giving as best possible the clear meaning of God's word. It's not a matter of me trying to convince you to believe what I want you to believe. It's a matter purely of me opening up this book and saying, look for yourself. Is this not what the word of God is saying? And you be the judge of that. My prayer is that, like Paul said, Timothy, I would be diligent to present myself approved unto God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing, accurately handling the word of truth. That's all I want to do. That's that calling. And it's a solemn duty. You know, these are calls of God for the body of Christ. It's not to be taken lightly or flippantly in any way. It's not a matter of, gee, what would I like to do for a living? Pastor looks fun. I think I'll try that. It's not that way at all. In fact, you know what the Lord says in James chapter 3, verse 1? "My brethren, do not many of you become teachers, knowing that we shall receive a stricter judgment." I always shudder when I read that verse. But brethren, these are gifts to the body of Christ. The apostles, the prophets, evangelists, pastors and teachers, pray for us. Because there's God's gift, because he loves you guys. Now, here's why. Here's why he's given them to the church. Look what he says in verse 12. He's given these for the equipping of the saints, for the equipping of the saints. They're given to equip the saints, brethren, to help spiritually equipped believers for life as well as for service. And of course, well, how do you do that? Well, it falls back on through the ministry of the word, through the ministry of the word of God. Here's where the truth and the power is. I mean, listen to this again. If you want scripture references for all this, come up to me afterwards and I'll send you a copy. But this is just an example of what the Bible says, what God says the benefits of the word are. Listen to this. This word is the seed of your new birth, of your born again. It is your spiritual food. It is the source of spiritual growth. It equips you for life and for service. It gives guidance and direction. It provides discernment. It gives wisdom and understanding. It cleanses from sin. It gives victory over sin. It's an effective weapon against the attacks of the enemy. It brings comfort in affliction. It's a source of inner joy and delight. It, following this, brings stability in times of crises. It increases faith. It sets you free. Moses put it this way, it's not just idle words, it is your life. Hey, brethren, think of that for a minute. That's equipping the saints, isn't it? Listen to this. Do you realize, because we are in this word, because we're sharing this word right now, that an equipping is going on right now? That's what the Spirit is doing. So with that in mind, listen to how Paul exhorted Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 4. Verses 1 and 2. I charge you therefore, get this charge, man. I charge you therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead at his appearing in his kingdom. Preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering or patience and teaching. Go for it. Give them the word of God. You know why? The prophet Isaiah from the Lord put it this way, Isaiah 55, 10 and 11. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven and does not return there, but waters the earth to make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing to which I have sent it. God said, it's my word. You know, sometimes I can get discouraged. I go, Lord, is this doing any good at all? And you know, it's always the Lord in my heart saying, shut up, in a nice way. He said, it's my word, it's not you. And my word will not return to me void. And so the best thing I have to give you for your equipping as a believer is his word. That's why we center on this. Peter and the apostles, when the church was growing by leaps and bounds in Jerusalem, and there were so many things to do. You know, pastors can get diverted with so many different things to do. And it was a situation where the widows in the fellowship, you know, they were providing meals for the widows, you know, preparing meals, a place where they could come and eat. And it was just the work was getting overwhelming. And Peter finally called the body together and said this in chapter 6, verse 2 to 4. They summoned the multitude of the disciples and said, it is not desirable that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Therefore, brethren, seek out from among yourself, from you, seven men of good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. Why? Because it's the equipping of the saints. You know? It's what God is doing. I know that this is an absolute God thing because, as we said before, it's a living word. And it's a supernatural working of the Holy Spirit that goes on. You ever noticed somebody that gets on fire for the Lord? I'm sure you've all, one place or another, one time or another, maybe it was even you. Just fire for the Lord. And you ever noticed how they get on fire for the Lord, and then all of a sudden they just have this hunger for God's word. They just can't get enough of the word. They just want more and more of the word. That's the unctioning of the Holy Spirit for their spiritual equipping. They have that desire, you know, because it's their spiritual food, and it brings forth spiritual growth, and they just want as much of that as they can get. You know, I have been studying this book diligently now, I hate to admit it, for over 40 years. And you know something? You would think I'd be at the point where, okay, enough's enough. I know the book. That's it. You know, put this aside, I'll look for something else, you know? But it's not that way at all. It's like that desire and you know, yearning for the word and the need for it and the nourishment I get from it is still there as much as ever. I feel like I'm still plummeting the depths of this book. Now listen, when I say the depths of this book, I'm not talking about hidden deep truths. I know something you don't know. I remember 25 years into the ministry, hearing Chuck Smith speak to pastors, and you know what his message was? It was his message, Jesus loves you. And I got so ministered to, I'll never forget, walking out of there and just, thank you, Lord. Jesus loved me. I knew that. But how it was ministered to my spirit afresh. I think it was Peter or Paul that said, you know what? For me to repeat these things is fine with me, and I know it'll bless you. I'm not against repeating what I've said before. That's the power and the amazingness of this word. So this word, he's given these gifts to the church for the equipping of the saints, and it's continuing to equip more and more and more for that victorious overcoming life and an effective service for the Lord. And that brings up the next point, because he goes on, he says, it's for the equipping of the saints. Well, what's that for? Look what he says next. For the work of ministry. For the work of ministry. In other words, it's believers being equipped spiritually for effective service for the Lord. God says, I'm doing something here in the life of those believers. I'm using them for service. I heard a while back story of a after church, Sunday afternoon, you know, sometimes on a beautiful Sunday and it's after church, you know, you're going out and just enjoying the day and like that. There were these two middle school girls and they had sat in church that day and that they left and they, on the way home, they were walking to a park. I think it was in Chicago somewhere, to be honest with you. Anyway, they're kind of walking through the park and it was just, they enjoyed the church so much and everything. They plopped themselves down on a park bench there and were just yakking together about, wasn't that a great sermon? Remember when the pastor said this and they were talking about it, they were kind of excited about it. Little did they know, the bench was right by this big hedge behind them. And on the other side of the hedge, there was another bench facing the other way. And there was a guy sitting on that bench that was seriously contemplating suicide right at that moment. His life was in the total pit. And he heard these two eighth graders, girls, on the other side talking about Jesus. And they talked for a little bit, and then they got up and they went on. And instead of taking his life, he gave it up to the Jesus these kids were talking about. Those kids have no idea how God used them that day. No idea whatsoever. You know what? You know what was happening? Equipping was taking place. And ministry was going on, and they didn't even know it was happening. Didn't even know it. Isn't that cool? I was talking to my sister-in-law just this week, Joyce's sister. She called to talk to Joyce, but Joyce was busy, so she talked to me. Anyway, sometimes it's hard to get off the phone. But she shared something I thought was so cool, I want to share it with you. She lives in Southern California, and she, for years and years, has been a tutor for elementary age kids, you know. They come to the house, and she tutors them. Math, history, whatever, English, you know, she's a tutor. And she said there was this little elementary age boy that, you know, for some of those elementary years was coming to her for tutoring. He was a little Jewish boy. And the last time she saw him was when he turned 13 years old. And because, you know, she had been tutoring him for a while, she was invited to his bar mitzvah. And she went to the bar mitzvah, and she said, this was something else. She will never forget that bar mitzvah. I mean, it was no holds barred, man. Bar mitzvah, big time. And so that was the last time she saw him for years. And then she's downtown. She lives in Simi Valley. She's downtown. And this kid who's in his 20s now, you know, says, Mrs. Woolridge, oh, I'm so glad I saw you. Oh, I'm so glad. I've been wanting to tell you something. He said, I've become a Christian. And, well, that's wonderful. Virginia was never one to preach the gospel. She was there to tutor kids. But you know what? He said, the reason I wanted to tell you, because every time I'd come to your place, I'd see on your coffee table your Bible. And that would, it just stuck in my mind, that Bible on that coffee table. After my bar mitzvah and I went into my teenage years, I really rebelled, he said. And I took my bar mitzvah money, sounds like the prodigal son. I took my bar mitzvah money and I went to Hawaii to party down. Totally, you know. Well, he's on the beach, he said, in Hawaii. And this Christian comes up and begins to witness to him. And he said, as the Christian was witnessing to him, all he could see in his mind was the Bible on her coffee table. That was just stuck in his mind. And with the Bible on her coffee table in his mind and listening to this guy, inside he said, this is the truth. This is the way of life. I know it is. And he received Jesus and became a follower of Jesus Christ. Now, Virginia actually had known it had happened, but she didn't know the details. And it was really neat to run into him and find out that her Bible on her coffee table had such a big part in that, you know? Because the mother had called her up a while before that, a little while, I don't know how long, but had called her up and just happened to say to her, you know what? We spent $30,000 on my son's bar mitzvah, and he becomes a Christian. You just don't know. You know, that's God's purpose for the body there, to be out there. I remember a fellow telling me about a dream. I don't know if he made it up or if it was true. But he said in this dream, he was in the orange groves everywhere. And he went to this one orange grove, and there was a bunch of people gathered around the base of one tree. And the foreman was on a ladder in the tree, and he was up in the tree, and he was pulling oranges down, and he'd pull one and everybody would, oh, that's really cool. But some were saying, oh, he should have got that. I don't know why he picked that one, that, you know, and things like that. And but he was up there doing that, and everybody was staying around watching. Goes down to another orange grove, and then here's all these people running around, ladders everywhere, you know, they're picking oranges, bushel baskets are being filled with oranges. Foreman's around just sort of guiding, helping, you know, directing a little bit, but what's going on? And it was a message to him. It says, so much of the church is like the first one. They're looking at the pastor and they're paying the pastor to do the work of the ministry. The second one is God's plan for the church. It's the body being equipped and out there doing the ministry themselves, you know, the work of ministry. And look at the difference. You know, that is the point Jesus actually makes when he said to his disciples in John 14, 12, "Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these will he do, because I go to my Father." He had just said previously, "I'm going to go to my Father and send you the Holy Spirit." And so he says, "You're going to do greater works." Well, we look at that and we go, "Give me a break. Are you kidding? How in the world do we do greater works than Jesus?" Well, I submit to you two things. One is there was one Jesus, and there's millions of Christians filled with the Holy Spirit proclaiming the good news all over the world. That's greater works. You know what else? Jesus did some marvelous things. He healed lepers, you know? And you know, did wonderful things like that. But it wasn't until he died on the cross and rose again that the gospel of eternal life through Jesus Christ came to the world. And those apostles could go out, those disciples could go out, those believers could go out and tell people Jesus loves you. And he died to save you. And by receiving him, you can have everlasting life. And you know what? I think a leper being healed of leprosy is a wonderful thing. But that doesn't even compare with a lost soul being saved unto eternal life with God in heaven. No comparison. "Greater works than these you will do, because I go to my Father," he said. You see, the point is the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, teachers have been given to the body to help equip them. And then those saints go out and they get scattered all over the place in service to the Lord, reaching out to others and ministering to one another, and look what God is doing. That's the spirit of that. And then he goes on and he says, here's his purpose in it going on. He says, "For the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ," he says. That's the building up of the body. The body gets built up. The body grows spiritually, grows numerically. Good things happen. You know, when Calvary Chapel first began with Chuck Smith down there, it was such a phenomenal work. It was on the cover of Time magazine at one point. And reporters were coming and saying, "Okay, what's the secret? What's going on? What is your evangelistic program? What kind of strategy are you implementing here?" And you know what his comment was? Because it was totally out of his hands. It was, "All I can say is healthy sheep reproduce." You know? And look what the Lord is doing. He said, "This is for the building up of the body of Christ." And then his goal along that line, look at verse 13. "Till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God." Brethren, this is what he's drawing us to, where it be one heart and one mind in this way, in trusting and depending on our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, there can be conflicts in churches. And are we going to depend on human logic, human reasoning, human arguments? Or are we going to trust in Jesus to lead us, to guide us, and to give us wisdom? What are we going to do? Can you imagine if a committee had gotten together to decide how to take the city of Jericho in the Old Testament? There's Joshua. "Okay, what's the plan, Joshua?" You know, he's like the pastor. "We're going to march around the city. Once for 6 days, we'll march around the city. On the seventh day, though, that's the big one, we'll march around the city seven times." They're going, "Already that doesn't sound too exciting to me." "And then what? Then what?" "Then we're going to scream our lungs out and blow our trumpets. That's what we're going to do. And God's going to give us the city. Walls are going to fall down flat and everything." That won't work. That's not the way you do it. You know? You know what the Lord said? Isaiah 55 again, 8 and 9. My thoughts are not your thoughts, nor your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. You know, he's got his way. You know, I'm so blessed with the board that we have in just, you know, working together to provide, you know, leadership for the church here. I've been on other boards where, oh dear, you know, it just can turn into almost a fist fight. And to get together with a bunch of guys and to pray together and to seek the leading of the Lord. Now, we don't want to throw reason to the wind, but brethren, more than that, we want to be sensitive to the leading of the Holy Spirit. And every one of the guys, we spend most of our time praying. And I think we reap the benefits of it, the way we just seek the leading of the Lord. But all of this, everything given here, brethren, is that there might be unity of heart and mind in this, in trusting in and depending on Jesus. Here. Let's see what he's going to do. Let's see how he leads, you know? So, and furthermore, along that line, he adds knowledge of the Son of God to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Wow. He's saying, have I got plans to bring you along? And I've gifted, and I've blessed, and I've poured my grace out to this end. That perfect man doesn't mean sinless perfection. The word there, teleos, it means complete. It means mature, you know? Come to that place of steadiness in the Lord. It's just that peace in the Lord. It reflects kind of a Christ-likeness. You know what I noticed in the Gospels? Circumstances never upset Jesus. You know, the disciples would lose it, but they never upset Jesus. The disciples are, what are we going to do? Oh, no, you know. I mean, when they got out there on the sea and the big storm came and they thought they were going to sink and Jesus was sleeping in the back of the boat, you know. And finally, they realize that they're going, well, we better wake up the master because it looks like we're going down, you know. We better let him know. So Jesus thought you might like to know we're going down. And Jesus, just calm as can be, you know, stands up. Looks at the wind, the waves, peace, be still. Okay. This guy's something special. But you know what he said? He said, oh, you of little faith. What's he talking about? I'll tell you what he's talking about. When they got in the boat, Jesus said, let's go to the other side. He did not say, let's go out into the middle of the lake and drown. Oh, you have little faith. This is the word of the Son of God. Let's go to the other side. You know? Isn't it neat to see some of these folks, you know, older believers that have been walking with Jesus for a long time, and they've just got that inner sense that, you know, the Lord's going to take care of this. Lord's going to get me through. He's not going to drop me now, you know? There's that steadiness. And I think that's kind of at the heart of what he's describing here. Steadiness in the midst of uncertainty. That maturity in the Lord. And so I want to leave you with this as I wrap this up. This is what God says I'm doing. I've given and I've gifted to this end. And I leave us with three closing thoughts. Number one, note, this is a process. It's what God's doing in our lives. Philippians 1:6, where he says, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. And so what we look at here is God said, this is my plan. This is what I am working toward in every single one of you. This is what I'm doing. I remember being at a youth conference years ago, and they gave us a great big old pin to wear, and it had these letters, these capital letters on it, PBPGIFWMY. How do you like that one? And so you say, what in the world is that saying? And it was this: please be patient. God isn't finished with me yet. Don't you like that? You know what I would say to you? Please be patient with yourself, because God isn't finished with you yet. He's in the process of doing an awesome work, an awesome thing, drawing us to the fullness of Christ himself. Whew. I know, it's got a long way to go, but there it is. Number two, based on what he has said here, brethren, I can't encourage you enough. Take advantage of every opportunity for that equipping. Take advantage of every opportunity you can for that equipping. God has given the gifts. He's given the means. He's given the Spirit. Take advantage of it. And then thirdly, remember. Remember, always remember why you're still around. Here you are. You're still here. Remember why you're here. He put it this way, the end of verse 12. For the work of ministry, for the edifying, the building up of the body of Christ. Believe it or not, Christian, you are part of that. And God can use you. That's his plan. You know what I have to say about that? Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, oh Lord, Lord, you've laid it out. You've just so laid it out there for us, and it's good news. It's great. You care about us. You love us. You're intimately involved personally in all of our lives in love and in grace. Oh, Father, thank you. And I pray now, Lord, that because it's you, Lord, that we would begin, maybe for some of us, it's beginning to take baby steps in walking worthy of the calling to which you have called us. And that's Jesus with us, Jesus in us. Jesus, Lord, Good Shepherd, Savior, Lover of our soul, Helper. Thank you, Father. Thank you. It's in his name we pray. And all of God's children said, amen. Amen.
Hi there. You know, if there was one thing that I would want you to know, if I only had one thing to say to you, it would be something like this: how much Jesus loves and cares about you personally, you individually. I know some of you right now would go, yeah, well, he doesn't have a very good way of showing it. But you know, that's because there's this huge, probably because there's this huge separation between you and him. And it's not his fault. You know, the Bible says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Every single one of us are sinners by nature, and we prove it out in our lives. But you know, it also says the wages of sin is death. That's in Romans 6:23. The wages of sin is death. You know, the word death means separation. That's literally what the idea of that word means, especially in New Testament Greek that the Bible was written in. And you think about that when somebody dies, a separation takes place. And not just from you from them, but a separation takes place in them. Their eternal soul, their eternal spirit separate from their body, and their body is left behind. And there's a separation there. Well, there's such a thing as spiritual death. And that is the separation between the God who loves you, the Jesus who loves and cares about you, and you because of sin. And that separation because of sin is the reason that we don't know and experience His love for us and a relationship with Him, a love relationship. You know, it's that separation, that sin that is the reason that we often feel so empty. We feel so aimless. We feel like life is really kind of meaningless and purposeless. And we have that nagging, empty feeling inside of us because God created you to have a relationship with Him. You are a creation of God, but we ourselves, you and me, we've caused that separation because of sin. And there's that separation actually has an eternal aspect because I mentioned your soul and your spirit are eternal. You know, you could go out and end your life, and God forbid that you ever would do that. But when that day comes, however it comes, you don't cease to exist. You just shed your body, but you go on. An eternal separation means our sin has caused an eternal separation from God. And the result of that is hell. And let me say something about that, one thing about that. Hell is hell. There's no getting around it. Don't think you're going to go party with your buds. Hell is hell. But God doesn't want any of us in that place at all. His heart is to save us. So even though the Bible says the wages of sin is death, that same verse goes on and says, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Jesus came and through His coming has brought us the gift of eternal life. He's the one that has it for you. But you've got that separation because of sin, which is death. But listen to what the Bible says. God demonstrated His love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ, Jesus, died for us. You know what that means? That means He took that penalty, those wages, that sin, and the condemnation of it, and the judgment of it, and the eternality of it, and the horribleness of it, and the hell of it, and put it upon Himself on the cross. He died an excruciating death on the cross. He didn't have to. He was the perfect Son of God and Son of Man. But He took that was on us, and He put it on Himself. And He died in your place and in my place. And you know what? That freed us from the penalty of death. That freed us from death. And that now gives us the gift of eternal life. You say, well, how do you know that even worked? On the third day, He rose from the dead. And Jesus lives forever. He's the only one that has risen from the dead. And He lives today because He is the Lord. And so now, simply through Him, you can have eternal life. But it's not enough just to know that. I think there's people that know that and nothing has changed in their life. It must be personally received. That's why the scripture says, if you acknowledge Him as Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you shall be saved. It says, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. John chapter 1 says, but as many as receive Him, to them gave He the power to become the sons of God. Jesus Himself said in Revelation, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him. And I will fellowship with him, dine with him, and he with me. It comes down to acknowledging your need for salvation. And that involves that word repentance, turning away from that and turning to He who loves you, cares about you individually and personally, and wants to save you eternally. And then receiving Him, believing on Him, and receiving Him into your heart as your Lord and your Savior. You know, when a person does that, Jesus has said in His Word, He never says no to that prayer. Would you like to pray that prayer now? I would like to lead you in it. Would you pray with me? This is for you, and it's not the words I'm saying, and it has nothing to do with me. It has everything to do with you and your heart and the God who loves you and the Jesus who died for you. Pray with me, will you? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you that you love me. I didn't know that you loved me the way you loved me, so much that you sent Jesus, that he became a man and he died, paid that death penalty for me, that I might have everlasting life as your gift to me. So right now, right here and right now, Lord, I repent of the old. I just repent of all that. And with all of my heart, I turn to you. And Jesus, I invite you to come into my heart and into my life and be my Lord and my Savior. Right here and right now, I acknowledge you as Lord and Savior of my life. Jesus, I believe in you. I believe you died for me. I believe you rose from the dead. I believe you are the Lord. And I receive you right here and right now today, this moment, as my Lord. Thank you for forgiving me for all of my sins. Thank you for saving my eternal soul forever. Thank you for coming in and being Lord of my life. Thank you that you are the one who will be with me from now on through it all, and I can depend on you in every area of my life. Here it is, Lord. It's yours. Thank you for so great a salvation. I receive that in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, the Bible says, whoever calls upon his name shall be saved. And it says in 1 John, it says, these things I have told you, I have written unto you, that you might know that you have eternal life. It's no longer a hope so. It's a thank you, Lord, know so. Because he said the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. And the theme verse of the whole Bible, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. And all I can say to that is amen and hallelujah. God bless you.
You are the source of life that can't be left behind. No one else will do. I will take hold of you, 'cause I need you, Jesus. To my rescue, where else can I go? There's no other name by which I am saved. Capture me with grace, I will follow.
I will follow you.
This world has
need you, Jesus. Come to my rescue.